Bangkok made of tree, and I'm happy that to see familiar faces today, that some of you might have joined our event, like the last two events already, but thank you for joining us at every event. But for some of you that just joined today, you are the most welcome. Thank you. Thank you, and hope to see you in the next one as well. So I have joined the community manager for Chenling Labs. I am helping Chenling. Building the community around the world, not only in Thailand, also in Europe as well. I'm happy to see the community growing everywhere, day by day, bigger and bigger. The reason why Chenling loves to host the monthly event like this all around the world, because we love to create a space for the people who interested in the blockchain technology, who want to learn more about the blockchain technology, not only the Chenling API, but anything that related to blockchain. We want to create a space for you to come and hang out with the same folks, with the same people that have the same interests. When you come here, you feel comfortable, you can make a good relationship with the people, you meet the new friends. Who knows, like in the future, when you people you meet today will become your business partner, will become the long-life friends. So you can create a new career together. You can create alpha together. So, same like Sergey, our CEO. I'm sure that you know that Sergey is our CEO of Chenling Labs. So, actually, I mentioned this every event, this story, because Sergey really has a strong belief that the great quality event can help something in the blockchain industry to help the world to drive the world in a better place. Like him back then, in state, when the Ethereum first started, he joined the first meetup in state for the Ethereum meetup. And from there, that he started to research about smart contract. So that became Chenling Labs today. So he really wanted to find a new circuit. Actually, yeah, and I hope that this will help you guys to start what you're already doing or continue something that you already started or create something that you have in mind in the blockchain industry. And and I won't take too much time about this. I will pass you to the first speaker, but the topic that we're going to, before we go into that, I would like to introduce you to Chenling Hackathon Spring. Actually, Chenling has Chenling Hackathon in every quarter of the year. So this quarter is from, it will start 22 April until 27 May. So if you miss the last live hackathon, so it is the chance, the good chance that you have the time to prepare before it started. If you wanted to join, if you are a developer, you wanted to join the hackathon, you have time to find a team. And I heard that this year we have more than 300K for the prize, and you will be, if you are the winner, you will be working closely with the VC and also get the help from the Chenling developer in your project as well. So, and today I have to thank my team because I cannot do this my own. I'm working for Chenling, I'm the employee, but I also have the team that they are the Chenling fans, that they help me a lot to build the community in each country. And in Thailand, we also have some people that they help me. Maybe you can raise your hand. I can, it's Sasha. Yes, it's Sasha and Alex.
Thank you, sir.
They are like one of the first. And then Fame, Mark, Boss, Tim, and Nelson. Yes, they are my team here and they are going to help me within every event. Like, so I just want to introduce them to you. And the topic that we are going to talk about today, so if you haven't already, join us in the meetup group and the Telegram group, so you will be in touch in every event in Bangkok and the next events. Or if you interested about anything about sailing that you want, you need my help, please DM me. I'm always around in the Telegram group. It's easy to find me, so just DM me. Yeah, and the topic that we are going to talk about today, the first one, today we have Kun Alex Pandewit. He is a DeFi influencer who runs the Earth DeFi fan page. So if you haven't already, please follow in the page. There are a lot of valuable contents that you don't want to miss to learn about DeFi. Kun Alex is going to talk about DeFi for beginner and why we should go for DeFi. What is DeFi about that? And the next one, it will be Kutkov Tunoblan from QSwitch. She is a developer for the QSwitch. And also QSwitch is integrated Chainlink. So today she's going to talk about why Chainlink Oracle is important in QSwitch and how does the Chainlink and QSwitch work together. Please welcome Kun Alex, the first speaker for us, and I hope you can learn something new and tonight gonna be fun. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you. So I would say this is my first stage here. Actually trying to go on stage. So please be gentle to me. I'm gonna teach easy DeFi because I want it to be whatever like people can understand. Even like you are like a 5th grade kid, I want people to understand that. So okay, my topic is that it will be DeFi for a beginner, why we go on DeFi. So yeah, and yep, on Chainlink meetup. Thanks for the place here. Okay, can you go to the slide? Okay, just a little introduction of myself a little bit. So I was in crypto since 2017. I was in DeFi in about 2011, so last year. And I was in Master of Finance, Corporate Finance, and from Mahidol University. So I try to understand a bit on crypto and try to keep learning. What I do is that like I also like do the another like just normal, general, traditional investment media channel. It's called FinTalk on the bottom right here. And also like I just go study on some courses. So I put it right there. If you want to check it out, what I do, or do I actually have knowledge, you're gonna see it today anyway. Okay. Yep. So okay, let's talk about the traditional finance first. Why DeFi gonna replace it? So what is going on is that like if you are into the traditional finance, what is that, what is happening? There's gonna be three party. The first party is gonna be lender. The second party will be the banker, and the third party is the borrower. So what you are usually normal are people are you are lender or you are borrower, and the bank are you know, unless you are working with the bank or you are the bank, you're not gonna know what's going on the bank. Neither do I. I never worked in bank before, but I just read about it. Anyway, okay. If you are lender, okay. Say I'm not sure about your country. Maybe I think a lot of you are from many countries, also Thai and many other countries. So yeah, feel free to introduce me and let me know about other country, about finance and banking. So in Thailand though, the lender will get about 1% or even less than 1%. At most 2%. But if you are a borrower, what you're gonna pay in Thailand, you're gonna pay about 15% to 25% yearly. So there's a gap between that. And what is gonna happen is that the banker, I would say they're not taking it, but they have expand. So what's gonna do that is that they have to pay for maybe like physically a bank, they have to have a branch, they have to have a cash delivery, they have to have a security system, make sure the stuff work well, and they use human power, they use human resource. So what's going on is that like they're gonna have revenue and it's gonna divide it by expand the cost, and they're gonna gain profit, which it depends on which bank it is. But what is going on is that like between that, about 14% to 24% can happen during the transaction between lender and borrower. So the DeFi, the smart contract, the blockchain, can whatever solve that, take away the banker. Next slide, please. So I think a lot of people here would be familiar with the DeFi already. I would say like a lot of people might invest in Bitcoin already, know Ethereum, know some other smart contract platform. But I will go over just so simple again, like in case like a lot of people might not be able to know what is DeFi. So DeFi is, decentralized finance. And if it can replace the traditional finance, it will be, for example, there's many type of DeFi, but say like on this specific case, it can be lending protocol. So which means like instead of you have to actually go to the bank, ask for requests, submit your form and do everything paper, maybe you even have to take your loan on your house or something, you don't have to do that anymore. You just deposit. Maybe if you want to lend, you can lend. If you have money, you can do the borrow. If you have money, you can lend it. And then if you want to borrow, you borrow it. It's going to be a little bit more complicated than that once you get in. But once it happened in DeFi, the yield that can happen, 13 to 23% can happen because we take out the banker. We replace with smart contract. Okay, first of all, lending protocol, smart contract, DeFi are not easy to build. But one is established. It can be easier and can take away the middleman. So that's, I think a lot of people learn and a lot of people like how DeFi works or how crypto or blockchain works. So, okay, they might take some fee because, okay, they have developers, they have some something they have to keep the treasury going on. So they're gonna make sure that it keep running well, but the benefit on lender and the borrower can gain the full benefit instead of like going to the banker. Yep, next slide, please. Okay, say, on that time, on the previous slide, I was going on for the traditional finance, right? This is also a traditional tourism or traditional whatever happened in your life. I want to keep it simple that you use it in your real life, not just like a liquidity provider, you farming. I don't want to use a lot of buzzword there, but I want to lay the fundamental how it works first. Okay, on this specific, say you are a traveler. If you're a traveler, right, you want to go to maybe say US. So what do you have to do? Okay, this is example that you are Thai and you have 100 baht and you want to go to US. What's the exchange rate? About 33 baht per $1 US, right? So what you do is that you have to go to the exchanger. So if I name it like super rich. So okay, it's easy. They have 100 baht or they have $3. It's easy, no problem. And okay, of course, they can track spread or transaction fee or whatever it's because they have to have a physical place that you have to go exchange your money. So you have to exchange your money before you go travel in US. Is everybody here myself? Okay, all right. Okay, next slide, please. Oh, okay, yeah. I didn't see it change. It looks the same. Looks the same, but it is not. Okay, now the tourist, the traveler are actually more richer. They're not gonna deposit only 100 baht. They're gonna deposit 1 million baht. Now the exchanger is like, oh, I don't have 100 million baht. I mean, 1 million baht. I don't have $30,000 as well. So what is that exchange gonna like? Oh, I can't serve this customer anymore. So it's gonna have a problem now. So next slide, what can happen is that, let's say the traveler, so they want to deposit 1 million baht, right? About $30,000. If the exchange want to make sure they have liquidity, they have some Thai baht, some US dollar enough, what they can do is that they can be maybe crowdfunding, not exactly crowdfunding, but okay, they can receive the liquidity from other people. So it's just say on the right side, lender can, many lender in DeFi world can come and provide liquidity. So if you heard a lot of that word, but you never actually really deposit it, it's basically you deposit your money and you lend the liquidity. So what it's called, basically if you deposit in the smart contract, it's called AMM, which stands for Automate Market Maker. So say like, okay, many lender are already here. Let's see, small lender, big lender. So now the exchange can have liquidity way enough that they can serve this customer, this tourism. So that if there's a lot of big pool traveler want to go, or exchange want to do some exchange, it can be easily done because there's so many lender providing liquidity. Yep, next slide, please. Okay, now the thing that I was talking about, it can happen in DeFi easily. So it can be copy and paste. So if you guys heard, the Uniswap was like the first DEX or decentralized exchange. So they can ask the liquidity, and they was like successful enough. And so many other players like, hey, Uniswap, you do very well. I want to copy your business. And it's actually easy to copy the business in DeFi, because like if they are open source, I'm not quite sure if Uniswap, I think it's open source, because so many people copy Uniswap and so many happen, like they just copy and paste and maybe change a little bit on the back end, but they take 80-90% of Uniswap, what they do, and maybe change the front end a little bit, so people say, hey, this is new DEX. So many players want to join, because what they do is that they reserve transaction, and then they get paid because people use it. The more people come and exchange, it will be easy to gain more money, gain transaction fee, so basically more yield in per year or like per day. Yep, next slide, please. Okay, now say in the previous problem is that like so many money for an exchanger. So there's maybe one guy, which is like maybe say Uniswap again or any other exchange. They're like, hey, I feel like if I just provide, I just give them the transaction fee. So maybe say like they gain, like if you provide liquidity on yearly basis, it might be 10%, it might be 12, it might be 20, whatever, it's not a lot, because like so many people are providing and not enough people are exchange. So if like say like that so much people are providing liquidity, yeah, this number gonna go up, but it can't go up that much, maybe 50 at most, but there's no way it can be sustained. So what they give the bright idea, the second revenue. So first are the exchange on the transaction, but the second idea is like, hey, let's give the liquidity provider some equity. So they create out in a, what's this called, governance token. So governance token are like the equity that the platform can clear. And maybe say like they can give out maybe 20, they can give out 100, they can give out 1 million. It's up to the protocol policy that they can just basically clear it out in there. Some of them might have some collateral, like they have to deposit some, but a lot of DeFi are like, hey, let's just clear something off the net. And say, why would that 1 million APR, okay, I haven't tell you guys, APR is stand for annual percentage yield. So basically, if you deposit your money, say like 100 baht, you're supposed to get 1 million baht within next year, because that's what you thought, it should gain 1 million baht. You deposit 100, you get million next year. Is that gonna be possible? Actually, it has to be divided by 100 again. Anyway, but the token value, why should this value can be sell at 1 million, or actually it should be 10,000? Why should it be? So the token or the protocol has some use case that it can sustain the value enough. So, okay, next slide, please. So the token has to provide some value on why is it important enough that it should have some value or it does not. This is the hard topic, and a lot of the token does not say retain value. But say if you invest in other, like say on the many cryptocurrency, some of them like smart contract platform token, are easily retain the value. You see, like if I want to talk about if the token are given for free, what a lot of people just, hey, if you give this for me, for free, I just sell it. I don't have to keep it. Like, what is the incentive that I hold your token and it, like, it should 10x? It's really hard on that. So there's many way to do a valuation, and I'm no way expert on that as well. So say a lot of stuff I'm saying, I'm not an expert at all. I just read about it, try to summarize for you guys. Anyway, yep. So next slide, please. So if you learn on the DeFi and cryptocurrency, once you dig deeper on a lot of topic, it's not easy. It's like something can be understand easily enough if you don't want to kind of dig deep. But if you dig deep enough, it's like so many mathematics. What the hell is this? Like liquidity provider, input, output, there's so many going on. Say, okay, by the way, I took this slide from Ajahniran, so let's give him the credit on that, because he is probably, I say, number one on DeFi knowledge educator. So if you want to know about DeFi, follow me, but also follow Ajahniran would be more wise. He's way, way wise. He had been in market so many years, and also like he been in traditional market as well. So say like there's so many stuff going on, like swap mechanism and how it's going on. I'm not gonna go over that today, but I wrote about it, some of them, and I let's say like a lot of swap is like if it happens, some place are easy to swap and also you retain the value you're supposed to get, and some places are not because of the liquidity. Let's say if I go back to previous example, if there's so many exchange, one exchange have money on maybe just 1 million baht, and the other exchange have 1 billion. If you want to retain the value that when you swap, you have to exchange on the players that have more liquidity. Say like the other one that has 1 billion. So, and also like impermanent loss. I'm not gonna go over detail on how hard it is, but basically I want to keep it simple. If you want to say provide the liquidity between two tokens, you just have to make sure that both tokens are value enough. Say like, I'm gonna say the most general one, Bitcoin, Ethereum, and maybe US dollar. So those are tokens that basically, I think maybe next 10 years, it shouldn't disappear. Right, Bitcoin is no way it's gonna disappear if we learn about it already. But the impermanent loss, basically, it can fluctuate between token or maybe between Bitcoin, Ethereum, or the other like token. If you go on providing liquidity between two tokens, one has value, like say Bitcoin, and the other one is like a rock that has no value. In the end, it will be like, say like in next year or next in 5 years, the other token has no value. Basically, your values go down to the drain. Like you almost have zero value on that. But if you provide on the pair that are retained value, US dollar, say like, okay, I say like dollar doesn't collapse. Like, because right now so many stuff going on. I don't know if Russia wanna go on war or something, but anyway. So basically on impermanent loss, just keep the token that you make sure you're gonna value it enough, people are gonna value it enough in the future. Yep, next slide, please. Okay, well, I'm almost run out of time, I talk too much. By the way, I'm sorry, I have to go some English and also some Thai because I have so many people are also Thai, I think. So let's say like so many players in DeFi are kind of thief. So if you go in some place and it's not safe, then you found some thief, your money is gone. You just have to make sure you use the DeFi protocol that are quite safety enough. So make sure you read about, by the way, all my articles are in Thai, so very sorry. But you follow my Twitter though, I post a lot in English. So yeah, if you want to read about the risk on DeFi, yeah, make sure you scan on that QR code. Next slide, please. I would say like, so basically there's so many stuff that can happen in DeFi. On the stuff I talk, it's only two examples, and I don't have enough time to talk a lot of them. But say like, we have another speaker we got, we have a Q-Switch, so she will talk about that, what it is. But say like, what you have to know is that like, there's so many layers on this DeFi. Say like settlement layer. So what we use is that maybe Ethereum, maybe Terra Luna, maybe Phantom. But there's like asset layer, which means like, why should we provide or keep this value? And the other like is like what you actually interact on the front end, on the stuff that you use the application. Okay, next slide, please. So I don't think I have time for this slide anymore, but basically like, hey, for example, Chainlink, it's a use case because it's a Oracle that provide the data and take the data that most of the protocol, I'm not sure about the number, maybe like say 70% or 80% of the DeFi and blockchain stuff, they use Oracle feed from Chainlink. So I think you guys want to study that. I think a lot of people know. I don't know much about Chainlink, so please feel free to educate me as well. So that's it for my slide. Can you keep going? Yep, keep going. I don't think I have time. Okay, basically if I want to talk, is that investment are easy and it can be hard. So if you look on daily, then it can fluctuate. But if you look on long term, you want to keep your mindset long term enough, then you look at that kid and maybe you start at maybe 1,000, but it can be a million. But if you look at daily, it can be hard because if you go to risk, then you can lose your money as well. Yep, next slide. So if you want to read about my article, it's in title, very sorry. But yeah, take a look. Yep, keep going. This would be something that I have. I'm from Mahidol University. So I will have a Metaverse course, which will be in Thai again. So the price will be at, I'm not gonna say it, but I'll say more in Thai. So yeah, if you are interested in, we haven't posted this on public yet, but if you want to know about it, it just follow on this page, or can you go next slide? And we have 10 weeks of the course, which if you want to follow on our Mahidol alumni and on the line. So yeah, and we have many speakers. So if you want to know, for example, I think a lot of people would know Khun Sanjay. So Khun Sanjay will talk on blockchain and NFT. Khun Sanjay is from CryptoMind. Or say Ajahn Niran that I just talked about it. So he's going to talk about, that typo, I'll fix that. We'll talk about FinTech and crypto. And another person that I think a lot of people would know, if you use exchange in Thailand, Web 3.0, Khun Neung Paramin. He's from Satang Pro. So I think that should be end of my presentation in English. Okay, well, we will go in Thai. Thank you. งั้นไปตั้งแต่สไลด์ต้นเลยครับเพราะว่าเดี๋ยวพูดภาษาไทยอีกแรปอีกภายใน13นาทีโอเคครับรอโอเคสวัสดีครับก็นะครับDeFiนะครับถ้ายังไม่ตามนะครับก็เดี๋ยวมี QR code ให้กดตามมันได้นะครับก็ไปเลยดีกว่าเพราะว่าผมว่าคนไทยทุกคนอาจจะฟังภาษาอังกฤษออกแล้วเลยแหละผมก็พูดไปงั้นแหละให้ทางไลฟ์ได้ดูด้วยอีกรอบหนึ่งนะครับก็โอเคผมจบไม่ดนนะแล้วผมก็เล่นคริปโตไม่เรียกว่าเล่นสิลงทุนคริปโต2017แล้ว DeFi ก็เข้ามา2021นะครับก็ประมาณปีที่แล้วนะก็ไปเรียนนู่นเรียนนี่นะครับมีใบเซอร์ใบอนุญาตพลต.ด้วยนะครับก็เป็น IC Plane IP Complex นะครับก็เพื่อที่เป็นฟรีแลนซ์นี่แหละครับแล้วก็จบไม่ดนที่Corporate Finance นะครับแล้วก็เรียนนู่นเรียนนี่นะครับทำ investment เกี่ยวกับการลงทุนอีกนิดนึงก็ชื่อ FinTalk นะครับผมก็จะแชร์ในเพจผมด้วยนะครับถ้าใครอยากดูการลงทุนก็ชวนสปีกเกอร์ต่างๆมาพูดคุยต่างๆอะไรเงี้ยครับโอเคครับ next slide เลยครับโอเคเดี๋ยวผมเล่าคร่าวๆแล้วกัน DeFi คืออะไรนะคือเล่าให้ฟังแบบให้ไปโลกการเงินดั้งเดิมก่อนที่ทุกคนใช้งานอยู่เรามีคนยืมนะครับกับแต่นะเลนเดอร์คนให้ยืมนะครับบอโรคือคนยืมนะครับแล้วก็มีแบงก์เกอร์ก็คือนายธนาคารนะคืออย่างนี้ถ้าเราฝากเงินไว้ในธนาคารเนี่ยเราก็มีแค่เท่าไหร่ได้เปอร์เซ็นต์2%ดีไม่ถึง1%ด้วยนะเราฝากเงินไว้ในธนาคารแล้วก็ไอ้คนยืมนะครับคนยืมก็นู่นเลยจ่ายกันปีนึง10% 15% 25%ก็มีนะผมว่าจริงๆเกินเรทเยอะก็มีเลยถ้าไปเจอธนาคารนอกระบบก็โดนกันปีละเป็นร้อยเป็นหลายร้อยเปอร์เซ็นต์ก็มีนะก็เลี่ยงไว้นะครับพวกนอกระบบนะแล้วไงมันเกิดอะไรขึ้นตรงที่แบบในธนาคารเนี่ยเขาก็กินเปอร์เซ็นต์ระหว่างทางเราเนี่ยแหละมีคนฝากมีคนยืมนะแล้วก็มีคนสิ่งที่เกิดขึ้นคือเขาได้รายได้นะครับแล้วเขาก็มีค่าใช้จ่ายนะต้องมีธนาคารมีสาขาทุกวันนี้เราเลยเห็นเลยนะว่าธนาคารทั้งหลายอ่ะก็ทยอยปิดสาขาไปนะก็ธนาคารเนี่ยเขาใช้ค่าใช้จ่ายเยอะนะอย่างเช่นแบบโอ้มีสาขามีโอนเงินมีขนส่งเงินคือเงินจริงนะครับบางทีต้องแบบมีความปลอดภัยที่สูงมากนะกว่าจะโอนเงินกว่าจะย้ายเงินไปได้นะมีพนักงานต้องจ่ายนะคราวนี้มันมียอดตรงนี้ครับ 14% ถึง 24% เนี้ยตัวนี้ตัวเลขตรงนี้อาจจะเป็นตัวเลขประมาณหนึ่งนะอาจจะเรียกว่าสมมุติก็ได้นะครับแต่ว่าถ้าลบกันเงินเดิมครับมันเป็นอย่างนี้นะสิ่งเกิดขึ้นคือถ้าเราไม่มีธนาคารแล้วล่ะเราเปลี่ยนเป็นโลกของ DeFi แล้วครับขอสไลด์ถัดไปนะครับโอเคถ้าทุกคนรู้แล้วนะว่าตัว DeFi มันเป็นยังไงผมขอย่อคำย่อก่อนนะ DeFi คือ Decentralized Finance นะครับสิ่งที่เกิดขึ้นเนี่ยคือถ้าเราไม่มีนายธนาคารล่ะแต่เราอยากให้ยังมีการกู้เงินยืมเงินอยู่นะครับมันมีสิ่งที่เรียกว่า Lending Protocol นะถ้าเราใช้บนโลก DeFi แล้วเนี่ยโอเคผมว่าทุกคนในห้องนี้น่าจะเข้าใจบล็อกเชนเข้าใจคริปโตประมาณนึงแล้ว Smart Contract ก็เราเปลี่ยนแปลงไม่ได้เลยน่าเชื่อถือมากเลยอะไรเงี้ยสิ่งเกิดขึ้นคือถ้าเรามั่นใจในระบบเนี้ยเพียงพอเราเชื่อใจในระบบนี้เพียงพอเนี่ยเราก็ฝากเงินไปในระบบสิไม่ต้องผ่านใครแล้วแล้วก็โอเคตัวระบบก็โอเคมีกินเปอร์เซ็นต์ไปบ้างแหละแต่รับรองว่าไม่ถึงเท่าในธนาคารที่เราฝากอยู่ในธนาคารทั้งหลายนะครับโอเคซึ่งมันจะมีโทษครับกลับไปนี่ก็คือมันมีแกปตรงเนี้ย 13% 23% ตรงเนี้ยแกประหว่างทางที่สามารถเรียกว่าเซฟได้แล้วกันแล้วก็กลับไปหาคนที่ยืมหรือไปหาคนที่ยืมเงินเท่ากับยืมเงินหรือว่ากู้เงินมากกว่าเดิมนะโอเคครับโอเคอีกรูปแบบหนึ่งนะครับก็คือจะเป็นอย่างเช่นอันนี้ผมก็ยกตัวอย่างแบบเหมือนรูปแบบทั่วไปที่คนเข้าถึงแล้วกันนะอย่างเช่นว่านะครับคือเรายกตัวอย่างอย่างนี้นะสมมติเรามีนักท่องเที่ยวนะครับนักท่องเที่ยวไปเที่ยวอเมริกาเป็นคนไทยนะเป็นคนไทยก็อ่ะเราไปเที่ยวเราเอาเงิน100 บาทไปฝากได้มา $3นะ exchange ก็คือแบบ super rich อะไรเงี้ยก็ไม่มีปัญหาเพราะว่าเขามีเงินอยู่แล้วเขาก็โอเคคุณเอามา100 บาทใช่ไหมผมให้คุณ$3อาจจะกินข้าวเที่ยงนิดหน่อยก็กินไปนะครับเขาก็ตัว exchanger เนี่ยหรือว่าแบบ super rich เงี้ยเขาก็ได้ส่วนแบ่งไปเขาก็กิน spread ไปเป็นเรื่องปกตินะครับโอเคครับ next slide ครับคราวนี้เกิดอะไรขึ้นล่ะถ้าการที่แบบจะมีแบบ super rich เงี้ยบางทีเขาต้องมีเงินเก็บไว้จำนวนมากเพราะว่าอะไรเพราะว่าบางทีนักท่องเที่ยวเขาไม่ได้แลกกัน100 บาทไงเขาแลกกันทีเนี่ยเขาแลกกันอาจจะแบบไปเที่ยวเป็นแสนเป็นล้านเนี่ยก็อย่างเช่นเจ๊คนนี้แล้วกันนะเป็นนักท่องเที่ยวเอาเงิน1 ล้านนะมาฝากไม่เรียกฝากเรียกว่าแลกครับแลกเสร็จแล้วเขาอยากได้$30,000นะครับก็โอเคคราวนี้ exchange บอกว่าเฮ้ยพอดีอันนี้จะเป็น super rich number 0นะครับยังไม่รวยมากยังไม่มีเงินเยอะก็วิธีก็คือทำไงดีล่ะเขาต้องไปหาเงินทุนละหรือเขาต้องแบบต้องมีเงินส่วนตัวอยู่แล้วอ่ะถึงจะเริ่มธุรกิจนี้ได้นะเขาก็ได้ไอเดียปิ๊งขึ้นมานะครับ next slide ครับได้ไอเดียปิ๊งขึ้นมาครับสมมติว่านะครับสมมตินะตัวเทรลเลอร์เนี่ยเขาอยากจะแลก1 ล้านแต่ว่า exchanger เนี่ยแล้วเขาจะทำยังไงให้ชัวร์ว่าเขามีเงินล่ะสิ่งเกิดขึ้นคือโอเคเดี๋ยวเขาเปิดเป็นรูปแบบอย่างนี้เขาระดมทุนให้คนมาเพิ่มสภาพคล่องให้กับตัวบริษัทเขาได้คุณมาฝากเงินไว้กับบริษัทผมนะเดี๋ยวผมอ่ะแบ่งส่วนแบ่งคุณให้เป็นค่าธรรมเนียมที่คนมาแลกนู่นแลกนี่นะก็เขาก็เลยไปคล้ายๆกับหา lender ต่างๆนะครับ lender มีเจ้าเล็กมั่งเจ้าใหญ่มั่งนะก็ทีนี้คำใน DeFi เนี่ยเขาจะเรียกว่า provide liquidity นะครับเขามาเพิ่มสภาพคล่องให้กับบริษัทตัว super rich นี้เพราะว่าเขาจะได้มีเงินเพียงพอในการแลกเปลี่ยนแล้วเขาก็โอเคกินเปอร์เซ็นต์ไป 10% แล้วก็แน่นอนก็ไปแจกจ่ายให้กับคนที่มาฝากเงินด้วยนะครับคือไม่ใช่แบบเฮ้ยผมรับคนเดียวนะผมก็คืนเงินให้กับผู้คล้ายๆเรียกว่าผู้ถือหุ้นก็ได้แต่ว่าพอดีไม่ได้ให้หุ้นนะครับก็ให้เป็นค่าธรรมเนียมไป profit sharing นะโอเคซึ่งมันก็จะมีถ้าในรูปแบบ DeFi จริงๆเนี่ยเขาจะเรียกว่าถ้าตรงนี้ครับมันเป็น DeFi เลยนะแบบไม่ได้มีตัวกลางแบบ Super Rich ละมันก็จะเป็นเขาเรียก AMM นะครับ Auto Market Maker นะครับก็ทำให้ตลาดมันสามารถรันเองได้ด้วยการที่เรามีระบบที่มันฟิกไว้เรียบร้อยแล้วนะครับประมาณนี้แล้วกันโอเคครับ next slide ได้เลยครับ อันนี้ถ้ามีผู้เล่นมากเกินไปล่ะทำไงสิ่งที่เกิดขึ้นคือก็เดี๋ยวต้องมีnext slide ครับสิ่งที่เกิดขึ้นเนี่ยคือโอเคปกติแล้วเนี่ย1 exchange 1 super rich เนี่ยเขาอาจจะมีแต่ค่าธรรมเนียมแค่ 10% เองแต่ว่าถ้าเขาอยากได้ไอเดียใสๆล่ะอยากให้คนมาฝากสภาพคล่องไว้เยอะเขาก็วิธีก็คือเขาอาจจะแบบเฮ้ยเสกจำนวนผู้ถือหุ้นให้หรือว่าเสกเป็นเขาเป็นโทเค็นให้ถ้าเกิดรูปแบบของคริปโตนะคราวนี้เสกเนี่ยเขาจะให้20% ต่อปีก็ได้เขาจะให้100ก็ได้ให้ล้านก็ได้อันนี้แล้วแต่นโยบายบริษัทหรือนโยบายตัว DeFi ซึ่งแน่นอนว่าถ้าเสกเยอะแจกเยอะแล้วตัวโทเค็นเนี่ยไม่สามารถเก็บมูลค่าได้มันก็จะแทบไม่มีประโยชน์นะครับก็ดังนั้นเนี่ยเรื่องโทเค็นเนี่ยเดี๋ยว next slide ได้เลยครับคือเรื่องโทเค็นเนี่ยมันจะมีว่ามันควรจะมีมูลค่าหรือมันควรจะไม่มีนะครับอันนี้เป็นสิ่งที่ต้องถกแล้วก็ต้องเข้าใจลึกซึ้งหน่อยนะครับซึ่งก็มันก็จะแล้วแต่ว่าตัวโทเค็นเนี่ยทำไมมันควรมีอย่างเช่นแบบเมื่อกี้ผมให้ค่าเมื่อกี้นะสมมติเขาบอกเขาแจก1,000,000%เนี่ยถ้าแจกแล้วมันไม่มีประโยชน์จริงในการเก็บถือไว้แล้วก็ยังไงอะไม่มีประโยชน์ก็คนก็เทขายถ้าใครตามคุณคิมแดดดี้นะครับคุณทางคริปโตมายนะก็เจอโทเค็นโกลบอลโทเค็นนะเทให้ยับนะครับคำพูดติดหูนะครับเราไม่ควรต้องเก็บไว้ยกเว้นว่าโอเคเราเก็บโทเค็นที่มีประโยชน์จริงควรจะเก็บมูลค่าของตัวมันได้หรือมันควรจะมี use case ในอนาคตก็อาจจะทำให้เก็บไว้แล้วเพิ่มคุณค่าในอนาคตครับโอเคเรื่อง DeFi ก็อาจจะก็มีเรื่องหลายเรื่องนะยุ่งยากนะครับก็เดี๋ยวลองอ่านเพจผมแล้วกันนะหรือว่าตามอีกสไลด์นี้ก็คือเอามาจากอาจารย์นิรันดร์นะครับก็ไปตามอาจารย์นิรันดร์ได้นะครับก็แกก็จะพูดเยอะเลยแล้วคอร์สแกก็ดีมากคอร์สแกนะครับสมัครแล้วก็บริจาคให้หมาแมวด้วยนะก็เรียกว่าอาจารย์เขาไม่รับค่าผลประโยชน์ใดๆเลยเขาบริจาคให้ทางหมาแมวเลยนะครับผมอธิบายเรื่องเดียวแล้วกันเรื่อง impermanent loss นะครับแบบเร็วๆ impermanent loss คืออะไรนะครับ impermanent loss คือเราต้องเวลาเราไปเพิ่มสภาพคล่องให้ตลาด2จุดนะครับ2เหรียญนะครับเราต้องมั่นใจว่า2เหรียญนั้นน่ะมีคุณค่าจริงอาจจะเป็น Ethereum อาจจะเป็น Bitcoin อาจจะเป็นอย่างเช่นดอลลาร์ make sure ว่าดอลลาร์มันไม่สูญหายมูลค่าไปดังนั้นเวลาเราไปหาเหรียญแปลกๆเนี่ยเราถืออันนึงเป็นดอลลาร์คืออีกตัวหนึ่งเป็นเหรียญอะไรก็ไม่รู้มูลค่าในอนาคตเนี่ยอาจจะไม่เหลือเลยก็ได้เพราะมันโดนสวอปเททิ้งไปเรื่อยๆจนกระทั่งไอ้แพงของเราอ่ะมันไม่เหลือมูลค่านะครับโอเค next slide กันครับคราวนี้ก็ถ้าเราจะเลือก DeFi protocol ดีๆหน่อยเนี่ยก็อาจจะต้องคัดเลือกนิดนึงนะครับก็ติดตามจริงๆในสื่อประเทศไทยก็มีเยอะแยะเลยนะครับก็ยังไงเราก็ต้องมั่นใจว่าเราไปอยู่ในโปรโตคอลที่หาที่เรื่องไงปลอดภัยจริงอะไรเงี้ยหรือว่าถามคอมมูนิตี้ก็ได้แล้วก็ถามแล้วก็อย่าเชื่อนะครับต้องแบบต้องลองถามหลายๆที่ลองค้นหาด้วยตัวเองด้วยดู your own research อะไรเงี้ยครับเราจะได้มั่นใจว่าเราไม่ได้ไปเจออะไรก็ได้ที่เป็นตัวโกงเป็นโจรปลอมเปล่ามานะครับอันนี้ก็ถืออยากลองสแกนดูก็เป็น DeFi ที่ผมจะเล่าให้ฟังว่ามันมีความเสี่ยงยังไงนะครับเราก็ต้อง safety ไว้ก่อนนะครับโอเคครับ next slide ได้เลยครับโอเคครับก็เดี๋ยวจะมีเซสชันอีกเซสชันนึงนะก็เป็นของคุณทางคุณคิวสวิชนะครับก็เดี๋ยวทางคุณคิวสวิชจะมาพูดให้ฟังได้คุณก๊อฟนะครับโอเคครับ next slide ได้เลยครับโอเคครับคราวนี้เรื่องของเวลาที่เราจะหามูลค่าของเหรียญเนี่ยเราก็อย่าลืมนะว่าเหรียญควรจะมีความสามารถในการกักเก็บมูลค่าจริงหรือมันมีประโยชน์นะครับก็อย่างเช่นเชนลิงเนี่ยที่ผมเข้าใจคร่าวๆนะผมก็ไม่ค่อยรู้เยอะนะแต่ก็คือเขาเป็น Oracle Feed คือถ้าเกิดว่าบล็อกเชนต่างๆเนี่ยเขาต้องการ data แล้วเขาไม่มั่นใจว่า data ที่ไหนจะน่าเชื่อถือมากที่สุดก็เชนลิงก็จะเหมือน aggregate หรือค้นหาตัวที่เป็นกลางที่สุดน่าเชื่อถือที่สุดให้กับเชนลิงไอ้โทษครับให้กับตัวบล็อกเชนที่มาใช้ระบบของเชนลิงนะครับซึ่งก็เป็นหนึ่งในเหรียญที่มีคุณค่ามีประโยชน์นะครับซึ่งก็แน่นอนไม่ใช่การแนะนำการลงทุนนะครับยังไงก็ลองศึกษาเยอะๆนะครับผมแม้ว่าผมจะเป็นผู้แนะนำการลงทุนก็ตามนะครับปรึกษาผมก่อนได้นะครับโอเคครับผม next slide ได้เลยครับหมดเวลาแล้วผมขอแอบโฆษณานิดนึงก็คือนะครับตามเพจผมได้นะเดี๋ยวเราจะกลับมานิดนึงครับอันนี้ก็ได้ก็อย่าลืมว่าเวลาเราลงทุนนะครับเราอย่ามองระยะสั้นนะถ้าเราเล่น leverage เล่น future เล่นอะไรเสี่ยงๆนะครับพอแตกได้นะก็ลงทุนด้วยมองกันระยะยาวนะเล่นกันลองเทอมเดี๋ยวเพราะว่าถ้าเราเล่นระยะสั้นเนี่ยโอกาสรอดก็น้อยหน่อยนะแต่ว่าถ้าโอเคคุณเก่งจริงก็ดีครับดีแล้วมาสอนผมด้วยนะครับแล้วก็บอกด้วยว่าตัวไหนดีนะครับโอเคครับ next slide ครับนะครับก็ตามเพจผมได้นะครับก็เมื่อกี้น่าจะถ่ายกันไปแล้วนะ ก็โอเคก็ผมเขียนน่าจะ 2-300 article ได้ครับก็มาลองอ่านกันดูนะครับแบ่งเซสชันให้ด้วยว่าเป็นอะไรบ้างโอเคครับอันนี้แอบโฆษณานิดนึงนะครับมีเวลา1นาทีนะครับก่อนที่ไม่รบกวนผมกรอบแล้วครับก็โอเคผมอยู่มหิดลแล้วพอดีเดี๋ยวประมาณสักเดือน4อ่ะครับเดือน4เดือน5เดือน6เนี่ยเราจะจัดหัวข้อของ Metaverse นะครับที่จัดโดยสมาคมศิษย์เก่ามหิดลนะครับก็มีสปีกเกอร์เต็มไปหมดเลยจัดทั้งหมด10 week นะครับ2เดือนครึ่งนะครับราคา 45,000 นะครับแต่ว่าถ้าลองติดต่อผมมาได้เผื่อผมลองหาสล็อตให้นิดนึงได้นะครับแล้วก็เรียนทุกๆวันเสาร์นะครับเรียนที่ True Digital นะครับก็ลองติดต่อเบอร์นี้ได้หรือว่าทักไปทางเพจได้เดี๋ยวขอ next slide นะครับโอเคครับก็10 week เลยนะครับก็พูดคร่าวๆแล้วกันอย่างเช่นคุณมีคุณสันเจนะจากคริปโตมายนะครับบล็อกเชนนะครับมีอาจารย์นิรันดร์นะครับมีคุณหนึ่งปรมินนะครับก็เมื่อกี้น่าจะถ่ายกันหลายคนแล้วถ้าอยากสนใจนะก็ไปตามเพจของตัวมหิดลอลัมไนได้หรือว่าตัว LINE ก็เข้าไปถามได้โอเคครับผมก็ขอบคุณมากครับมีคำถามถามได้20วีครับถามหลังไมค์แล้วกันนะโอเคครับเราเชิญคุณกอล์ฟครับ
integrated with a lot of routers such as pancake routers and by swap routers and even the stable router like Elixir to trade the stable coin. So it makes sure that Qswitch can find the best router to trade your tokens. Next, the withdrawal meter, or when another name is Qposition. Actually, our company name is Qswitch, right? So it's come from this feature. So this feature is the first feature that we implement, that one click and remove liquidity and swap the token back to stable coins or any token. So, and also it's in one click. I also would like to add that our meter is also front run proof. Since we already calculate the minimum receive of the stable coins or destination token, so we can guarantee that if the user receives less amount of the coins, the transaction will be reversed. Okay, we are not done with the meters. Why? Actually, we developer from the Qswitch, we also like we also farm in Qswitch. So one of the features that we like is the we withdraw from one farm and then deposit into another farm. So combine this together is move meter. So user now can move from one farm to another farm in one click also. Next, the boost. Normal farm user already get the incentive from the farming rewards, but now Qswitch also given on top of the destination farm reward by giving more Qswitch token, and sometimes we work with the strategic partners to provide more incentive token. So now users can get three ways of APR and APY. And last, the take profit stop loss feature. Actually, take profit stop loss feature is not new to the traditional finance, but it's never happened on the blockchain before. So we make it happen on Qswitch, and the most important thing, the most important part in this feature is the price. So that's why I'm gonna talk about why price is important in Qswitch. Okay, in the liquidity pool in the Qswitch, actually, price can come from anywhere, right? Like I referenced Kun Earth talk that it can be from centralized exchange, Binance, or from the blockchain itself, since there are like multiples, like a lot of market. So one of the source of price is the liquidity pool. Okay, what is the liquidity pool? This is the basic normal Uniswap liquidity pool. So normally it consists of the two tokens in the 50-50 ratio. So in the liquidity pool, if we want to buy something, like for example, if I would like to buy Qswitch, there is no bid offer. I cannot say that I would like to buy Qswitch at this price, because the price is calculated from the amount of the reserve in the pair. So how do we calculate this price? Okay, let's do some little calculation. For example, this is the first pool. We have pool pair of BNB and Qswitch. For example, the first one, we have 100 BNB and 1 million Qswitch. So to say what is the price of this, we have to select the pool first. So let's say first quote is BNB. So the price in quote value equal to reserve quote divided by reserve token. So one Qswitch is equal to 0.0001 BNB. It's come from 100 is the quote and divided by 1 million. So that's why one Qswitch is equal to 0.0001 BNB. And on the other hand, if we use Qswitch at the quote, so 1 BNB is equal to 10,000 Qswitch. Okay, let's just keep this number in mind. And the next pool is the BNB and BUSD. BUSD is a stable coin. Okay, so do the same thing. If BNB is a quote, 1 BUSD is 0.025 BNB. And if BUSD is the quote, it's 1 BNB equal to 400 BUSD. So what is the purpose of this? If I want to know that one kill switch is equal to how many BUSD, I think people in this room can start calculating, right? Like one kill switch is how many BUSD? Okay, by multiply one kill switch is equal to 0.0001 BNB, right? And 1 BNB is 400, so we multiply these two values. So one kill switch will be 0.04 BUSD. So this is how we calculate the quote price relative price in the blockchain in the liquidity pool. Okay, so next question is can we very say that one kill switch is $0.04? Now I say dollars, not USD. Okay, I might have given some clue that USD is not BUSD. Okay, why? So can we assume that stablecoin is $1? Since stablecoin is a stablecoin of US dollar, right? So the answer actually is depends. It depends on scenario and depends on which stablecoin. Depend on scenario, like if we are developing a dashboard or UI, it might okay to assume that one BUSD is one US dollar, because the dashboard is not sensitive to price. If something goes wrong, it doesn't cost our money but just the experience, so it might be okay to assume. And depends on the price. USD. What about USD? USD is the Binance ticket with the fiat back, real dollars back. So they try to take the value of the USD to $1 by have the real dollars back, and it's held custody by Paxos. So is it still okay? So my answer would be yes. One day, if people don't trust in Binance, people gonna give the value to this stablecoin? The answer is no. Okay. Another stablecoin, UST. UST is the algorithmic stablecoin on Terra. So this one is different, but it's still stablecoin, but it has no dollars, real money is back yet, but it's used the algorithm to make it value to $1. So if something happened, like to the algorithm or in case of extreme market volatility, the price can be depegged. Like for this example, the exchange rate between the USD and UST is not, if these two are equal to dollars, it has to be exactly the same, right? But even this exchange rate is not the same. Like, it looks like UST is more expensive, dollars. So we cannot say that stablecoin is equal to dollars. Okay, next. Another example of the UST graph that sometimes in point in time that people would like to buy a lot of UST. So it made the price of UST go up very high. And that's on the bad, good news, like UST price go up. But how about if sometime in the future, the UST has some bad news or developer has some, they got hacked or something, the price of the UST could be down to zero. Okay, so far we have learned that stablecoins, they try to peg their value to a dollar, but in real practice, there are a lot of factors that cause them to deviate from $1. And the price from liquidity pool that I just do some calculation with you is relative to quote tokens. It does not relative to real US dollars or real fiat. So everything is in the blockchain world. They are not in the real world. And the liquidity pools when somebody swapping or do the exchange on the liquidity, the reserve keeps changing all the time. This means the price is keeps changing all the time. And how it means fluctuate, right? So how fluctuate? Okay. This is have fluctuate is they can have some event that's called manipulation. What is price manipulation? Okay, if let's say that is what is a liquidity, one of the liquidity pool. If we have some guy that doesn't mean good, he would like to, he has money, so he try to dump the token and he sell the token into the pool. What happened after this is mean the amount of the reserve, it has changed. So from ratio 1:1 is 1:2. So it this mean like price is not roughly to 50%. I didn't say about price impact, but to see the big picture that when somebody dump, one person can make change to the price of one liquidity pool. Okay, as a developer, what can I do, right? We have many market, right? So I might say, okay, maybe I will check the average price of many pools, many markets in the blockchain. What? This is possible? I said, yeah, yes, it's possible, but with more complication, it can cause more bug. And actually, I have a better way. Okay, next. Price Oracle. Okay, Price Oracle. Price Oracle is like the bridge between the real world and the blockchain world. What does this mean? Like Price Oracle is the Oracle is the person who knows everything, right? So what blockchain doesn't know, Oracle knows. So Oracle will feed the data back to blockchain, and blockchain has no way to know that is it correct or not, but it has to believe it. So when I say price Oracle, is it? So now, Juice is gonna use the price from the Oracle. So it depends. Why? Because Oracle is gonna be somebody. Somebody is one party that they have to take the price somewhere, like from the Binance or from the liquidity pool, the same way that I just showed you how to calculate. Or you just made up the number, right? Since it's one person and giving the price to the blockchain that, okay, this is the price of the BUSD or the price of something. So Oracle is good, but if this Oracle, what Oracle is got hacked or something, so the price can still be wrong anyway. So what Chainlink try to solve is this one. So Chainlink try to be decentralized data feed. Chainlink, they know that the centralized Oracle is has a problem. So what they are trying to do is that they have multiple or party working together to have the reliable price that can be verified and rechecked. Okay, a little bit how Chainlink price Oracle work. First, there is a price aggregators. With a price aggregator, actually, there are just they will aggregate the price the same way that I just showed you, like some Binance API or Coinbase exchange, or even on chain data like Uniswap and Sushi. So these two they calculate just the same way that I just showed you, but they calculate the raw data from anywhere and try to aggregate it and remove the outliers, like the value that doesn't make sense. And they also weight the price with the volume or time, so make it more cleaner. And next, Chainlink node operators, they will aggregate the value from the data aggregator again. And I think they don't use the average method. They are using the median, the middle value. So that's how the node operator get the price. Okay. And last, then this node operator will work together to get the aggregated price between each node, and then they will feed back to the chain, to the blockchain, like Ethereum, Binance Smart Chain, and Polygon. Okay. More about the node. Why this node are safe? The key to the decentralized is that all the nodes that aggregate the price, they are working independently. So if some node got hacked or have some problem, it will not affect the other. And also the node, they are operate around the world. So if something happens, some earthquake happens, other nodes still be working together to get the reliable price. And they also have the way to feedback the node that how well they are doing, right? So if some node happen to like miss, give the wrong data a lot, what they will have the bad score, right? So all the node they would like to continue working and feeding the data to Chainlink. That's why they want to keep their reputation. You can go to this link to check it out yourself, like okay, this node they only have like 0.06% of deviation. This is how the community audit. Okay, so that is the how Chainlink work. So this is the result. So now if I'm a hacker, how am I gonna manipulate the price with this structure? So at least I think I will have to hack maybe half, more than half of the nodes to feed the wrong data. And so if the price is very changing, what happened is the whole market, all the market in the world is the price is very decreasing. That's why Q-Switch is believed that Q-Switch will give the correct price, not just some lending pool or just some market, but all the market in the world. And I never mentioned the price plan, right? Because it's free. Since all the data feed back to the smart contract, so everyone has the right and to retrieve the data from the smart contract for free. And so Q-Switch choose to take the price. And you can see that all the pool that Q-Switch will do the take profit stop loss. Every pair has to have the price from Chainlink. That is the only the way list to use the features. So without Chainlink, Q-Switch cannot take risk. The feature works, but we cannot take risk to have that somebody to manipulate the price. And imagine if the price goes wrong, and we have the stop loss order and the price go down by 50%, right, in that picture. So our executor will execute the sale order. So what next after the sale, the price keep dropping, and what happened? So more stop loss order get executed, and the price is keep dropping until all the orders are executed and sold. So it's just like a domino effect with our reliable price. So that's why the only wireless pool is the price that are available in Chainlink. And that's it.
Anyone have any questions for Yigob?
Question number four.
What happened if there's not enough liquidity in the protocol? Then when they exchange, where are they going to take it?
In which step? You mean in the mixture?
In maybe the whole process.
Actually, Q-Switch will integrate with many liquidity pools. But if there is not enough, it will show in the price impact and in the UI. Actually, we haven't done anything to intervene, but the UI is clearly show that okay, if you take this step, your value will drop by 50%. Is this acceptable? And before you click. So because we already calculate in real time that what is should be the result and minimum reserve that we're gonna get.
That it is free, so I'm not sure how Chainlink can
about this, I'm not sure because anyone from Chainlink can answer this. How Chainlink, that is, we are using the data from the smart contract for free. So what is the, how revenue, Chainlink
gets
the revenue?
I get this question a lot, but actually, I cannot explain. But let's say that Chainlink focus on how to make the blockchain technologies better and run smoothly for all the DeFi and DApps and everything. So we do not focus on the revenue. This is the open source. I have to be honest that I don't have approval to talk about this as a market developer. But let's say that we don't really focus on the revenue, how we can make the how much we can make it income. But we focus on the technology, that's why we're here. We want to educate all the people about the technology so we can help DeFi space growing.
real strict than this.
No, please, please, Mr. Next, this call next strategy. So, we take the so people can deposit to choose which, and they can select that which dex that they would like to deposit and deposit it in the destination farm. So we have
farm. So you do what the dex does.
Like you deposit to pancake swap. One day you think that okay, you don't want to deposit in pancake swap anymore. Normally you have to withdraw from the pancake swap and then remove the liquidity and then add liquidity again at F swap. But in to switch as the middleman, you can just withdraw from pancake and deposit to F swap. Right? It's a helper, like on top of the deck.
Who's the lead investor?
If you switch, we receive the we have the private fund, so it's like normal process with other DeFi project. There is no like big party, just a private fund.
So, what is the role of the KSW token in the whole process?
Okay. Our government token is Q-Swiss, right? So what is that is we have a lot more features that for example like to use the move meters that I explained, you need to hold like 500 Q-Swiss tokens to unlock the features. So it's like utility tokens. Or if you hold 1,000 Q-Swiss, it will reduce the withdrawal fee and something like that. So it's like a utility that you gain more profit when you use this Q-Swiss, or you have to use the boost meter to get more incentive. You need to hold Q-Swiss.
All right, thank you everyone. I think it's about time for networking. Thank you for joining the talk today. We learned a lot. Thank you so much. And we have a networking. The duration 1 hour until 9 p.m. So please feel free to grab some drink and pizza outside and networking. Thank you guys. Thank you.